Inside the Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music. All right. Good morning, everyone. I'm saxophonist Will Donato, cancer survivor, proud cancer survivor, warrior, lover of life, and I'm pumped today. This show is great. It's content-rich artists. We love them. So we're going to extend the show till 6 a.m. this morning, serving chorizo and eggs in the lobby. So we have today a very special guest who gets his stuff done. He puts the work in. And he's got an amazing trajectory that I've really enjoyed reading about, from starting at 11 on trumpet to doing some specialized classes at Duke Ellington Performance Academy. He's in it to win it, and this is the real deal here. He's putting rungs on the ladder, and he's building the right way. Got a brand new record out, and he's got a show tomorrow at Mediterranean, Motown Philly. It might be Motown Philly La Quinta. Don't ask any questions.
Will, the show tomorrow is Motown Philly.
Yeah.
It features Lin Rountree and David P. Stevens.
First of all, like, the clear up, it's not some people saying, well, you're going to play My Girl.
Yeah,
you're
My Girl.
Play.
Yeah.
No, just my imagination.
Well, we should have done a better job launching that name, but it's really because I hail from Detroit, Motor City, home of Motown.
Yeah.
And David P. Stevens, great guitarist, my friend, buddy, hails from Philly.
Showman extraordinaire.
So we decided the Motown Philly thing, you know, with like the Boyz II Men came out with Motown Philly back in. Right. So that's the concept, but we should have done a better job explaining it a little bit before we came out. But we're not playing Motown music. We love it, but we're not playing Motown.
Motown
music.
Inspired.
Not playing
by
Motown music, but we do have the soul trumpeter.
Yes,
yeah,
we do.
So, yeah, we're going
to expect to hear a little soul.
Yeah, definitely a lot of soul. A lot of soul.
Yeah, so the opener too is Marie Antoinette. I don't know if you know her,
Maria.
But she travels with the Jazz and Pink, and she's also a solo artist, a harpist.
Yeah, can't wait. To
yeah, who was
very
on
respectful
our show.
And a really great opener.
And she's from San Diego. So if you haven't got your tickets yet, you want to see your man Lin Rountree here tear it up.
Yes,
and David P. Stevens. And
Snap, who puts it on, is watching right now. Shout out to Snap.
I've got some exciting news about Snap. I'm going to be teaching him saxophone with his good looks and saxophone playing.
There
look out, everybody.
Okay, so
that's all we need is another good-looking saxophone player.
Yeah, right.
We don't have enough of those.
And so everybody, to get tickets, the doors open at 6:15. To get tickets, go to www.whatsup.com. Daygo, daygo.com. That's What's Up Daygo. And already, you know, you better hurry up because this looks like a sellout. It really does. And and just to give people a reference, like out on the West Coast, people know Spaghettini. This place seats about twice the amount of Spaghettini. So if you sell out Mediterranean Jazz and Supper Club, that's like selling out Spaghettini twice.
Oh,
so
yeah. Well,
kudos to
you. That means guys. That's double the show, man. We got to double the energy on the show. That's why we got to have two of us.
Lynn's bringing twice the energy.
Exactly.
Now, Will Donato, if you don't mind, I need to pick on you for just a minute.
It's become a tradition on the opening of the show.
It has.
And so, as long as it doesn't take away from Maestro here, I'm fine.
Then a clarification for our listeners. Typically, we do a show the first and third Saturday of every month. But what we found out is that if you want your Lin Rountree,
that's right,
which we've been trying to get for 3 years, he lives in Detroit.
That's right.
He's not always.
Is that off the 405 by any chance?
Is that off the 405? You go to Hucumba and then make a right, and then at the Starbucks, you make a left.
Oh, the 406.
That's Detroit. Yeah, yeah.
The Motor City.
I wish you lived out here, dude.
Hey man. I wish I did, too.
You could write a ticket out here. I'm serious.
I wish I did, too, man.
That
may be in the future, though.
Some other people might lose some sleep. That's all I'm saying, though.
Okay, so getting back to the first and third thing, when we have opportunity to get out-of-town guests, which we have a lot lately, we're going to deviate. So we're always going to be 2 weeks a month, but it might not be the first and the third. So keep your eyes on Will's page, my page, and you'll see.
So we're following the Aztec calendar, not the Gregorian calendar.
We are.
Is that what you're basically saying? This is very complicated.
We are.
Just look at Facebook. And also, I'm really proud of this. We're the only show on web and internet TV that has a social media concierge who really interacts during the show. And this is a new uniform that we're requiring for our consultants. It is an animal print. And that is a real animal skin.
I'm going to borrow that for the show.
That's right.
So, you know,
and
out.
It says, I support PETA on the back. So
it does, but it's green. So
okay, and Will, tell the audience what you've been doing the last 3 weeks, because we haven't been on air for 3 weeks.
Well, you know what? Every day is a gift. It's not a trite saying with me. When you make it through a little bit of throat cancer, you wake up going, I got a second chance. And
love you, Will.
And I just had a chance to do a show in Florida for the Metro West Fest, and it was a great day. You know, Florida has this thing where they like to have rain for an hour, and as artists, when you travel all that way, your ears go down when you see the rain because you want to interact. I like to do the show. I don't want to just get my check because it's in the contract.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and by the way, shout out to my booking agent, Steve Butler. Fantastic.
Steve,
killer guy.
What's up, Steve?
And I got a chance to play with a rock legend who was headlining at the show, and it was Rick Derringer. And I just never know if these guys are just tribute acts at county fairs. But the guy is 72, Lynn, and he comes out with a trio, and he walks out front, Rick Derringer, no young buck, really playing the chords, him with a pedal board and a killer dread on bass with dreads down to his calves. And a drummer like I've never seen before playing out of rock.
Old school guys, old school.
Great. And he came out and he played Frankenstein as a trio.
Wow.
And it was so amazing. So then he asked me to play with him on a blues tune, and I was just so honored to play a closing tune with him. And I think I tripped him out because I don't like to overplay. I work enough where I don't have to tell my life story in one cameo. So I laid back and I was comping on the sax on the 145s. And he's looking at me like, this fool knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
But doing. It was such a fun experience. And you know what? I just got back from Texas, too. I got a chance to visit my father, and it just was a real fulfilling trip. But
yeah, well, congratulations on, I don't know what's up with you with the charts. It's like one day you're number 25, the next day you're number 10. Yeah, you know, I've seen you get most increased spins like 5 times. I've never seen anybody do that. This guy is rocketed up at the last second. Like, your single's been out there like, what, a year and a half?
It is. And actually, you know what? I kind of revealed a little inside secret template to my dear friend here. I always write from my set list. What do I need to refresh? So I'm not necessarily shooting for number one only or shooting for top 10. Would I love it? Of course I would. But I know that in the long term, like Tony Bennett, who just said he's getting his set list together at 85.
Nice.
That's a pretty cool thing. Yeah, he says, I'm finally getting my set list together.
Really cool.
So we can chip away at ours. But I really love to write for my set list. What am I lacking? And I build my albums that way because, like Lynn and I were talking about, if the few times that you really write for number one only, you've got this lullaby that you can't do anything with at your show.
Exactly.
And if you don't play it live, you're not going to sell. You're not going
to... Well, I hear that from a lot of artists that, you know, sometimes they don't like to play their number one hits or their hits that have done well on radio because sometimes they don't translate well live.
Translate.
And then you have promoters sometimes who say, hey, man, well, you got to hear that song. And they want to put your set list together. And you say sometimes... Sometimes that music doesn't translate well, and so that's what we're talking about.
And it really is important.
Moving forward, we're making songs that will translate well live, and just putting them. We're going
reverse. And then when you play them live, then they take on a life of their own.
Yeah,
because that 4 minute or that 3.5 minute radio edit now is 8 minutes.
Oh, easy.
And Lin's taking a solo that you want to hear that thing over and over again.
When I heard his Pass the Groove, immediately my brain goes, that's a set list, new, exciting thing. And for us we're almost like comedians. We know people are watching us on YouTube. We have to have fresh material at our shows. Yep. And if we've got this comfort zone on a selection of tunes, then shame on us. And when I heard Pass the Groove, I thought, he knows what he's doing.
Okay, we're going to go right back to that. In our gallery, which we forgot to mention, is from the Hollywood 360, a reporter that, Will and I feel very grateful for, because Cheryl has come to many of our shows.
It's Agenda Magazine now.
Yeah, and she is probably the most...
And author of this great
killer book.
Yeah, so Cheryl, why don't you just sit down next to Mikey for like a minute here and tell us about your new book. And one thing I wanted to mention as part of the intro, we've had a couple of tragic losses in the last couple of weeks, Kate Spade and Anthony Bourdain. I was a huge fan.
Me too.
Huge fan.
I was a huge Kate Spade fan.
Yeah, so Cheryl at one time had cancer.
Yeah. Wow.
And wasn't doing well and was very depressed. And she wrote a book about it. Mm-hmm. And maybe this could help some people.
Absolutely. Thank you, everybody. Yes, my book is called Passing Myself Down to the Grave. And you can find it on Amazon under that title. And yes, Jack is correct, because I too did try to take my life because of certain circumstances, but I was lucky and came up and out of it. As you all know, I'm a very successful now entertainment journalist, now author. So this book, Passing Myself Down to the Grave, is for people who perhaps have had breast cancer, who have gone through suffering, but this book is for everybody, because it's also about miracles and having all these miraculous things happen. And there is a full-length screenplay called Passing inside the story, because I was writing that screenplay when I started this book, and I decided to make it into a full-length screenplay, and it runs parallel to my story. So thank you.
Where can they find it?
They can find it on Amazon.com. All you do is go on Amazon under Passing Myself Down to the Grave. And thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl.
And Lin Rountree and I are negotiating rights to do the spoken word version on Netflix.
Okay, so Lin.
Some bongos and some harm and mute.
Yeah.
So Lin, we were fortunate enough to chat before the show here. Lin got in on time, like a few of our students. I was very, very grateful for.
Lin Rountree is in it to win it.
Yeah.
Hey, I try to be on
Buyers,
time.
Buyers, please note this.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
I try to be different. I try to be on time.
Yeah. So tell us about the single and how it came about, because I love the story.
Oh, man. Pass the Groove.
Now, the Pass the Groove, again, is the number one Billboard number one, which it's very prestigious to have a number one on Billboard.
Yes,
very difficult.
Yeah, very difficult.
Some people go their whole career, maybe not necessarily even having a song on Billboard, let alone number one. So kudos to you. And
thank
it's
you,
off of his latest CD, Stronger Still.
Stronger Still, yeah.
Okay.
Well, I mean, even the title of the CD is a testament to, it's my sixth studio recording. And after six CDs, you're really searching for your sound. And I think on this one, I finally found, like we talked about earlier, that we were writing music to translate live, and we're starting that way, and then seeing what works live, what kind of grooves work live, and then taking it into the studio. I did that on Soul Funky and found I had some success. So I said, I'm going to replicate that on Stronger Still. And with regards to Pass the Groove, that song came about, the great, great producer, Michael Broning, who produced 30-odd hits, top 10 Billboard hits for various artists, a lot of smooth jazz guys. He had kind of taken a hiatus from producing in the smooth jazz realm. Well, Jeff Lunt and I over the label, we communicate a lot when I
and that's Trippin' and Rhythm.
Trippin' and Rhythm Records. Yeah. Shout out Trippin' and Rhythm Records. Nice. I've been with them. This is my third project for Trippin' and Rhythm. Jeff Lunt and we we tried to visualize what we were going to do on the album, and I said, well, you know, I took that concept with him. I said, I have some songs that I wrote years ago, probably 8, 9, 10 years ago, and I didn't really know what to do with them. They'd been in my hard drive, and I said, well, you know, let's try to see if we can get a melody on them. And Michael Brown.
Well, how did you guys make contact?
Well, we'd already had contact with Mike. You know, he had done some stuff for Cindy Bradley. He'd produced Massive Transit, her hit, and several other things. He's worked
Marion
on
Meadows,
in Marion Meadows,
stuff.
Everybody. So he's accessible. It was just tough to get him to get back into producing in the smooth jazz. So that's how we approached him. We approached him with these tunes and said, hey, man, can you throw some melodies on him and see how we can evolve these songs? Because, you know, I'm kind of stuck with him. Gave me some ideas. It was great. He heard how I played, and I laid some of the melodies down. He said, hey, man, I like the sound of your horn. I like the vibe. I've got a song here that may work for your vibe. I said, hey, man, pass it on, man. I'm all ears. let me hear what you got. The second I heard it, I said, this is me all day.
Love it.
Was like, this is me. I said, you know, Mike, would you mind me laying some stuff on it? He was like, yeah, man. I laid it down. It took me 2 hours to hear what you hear, the finished stuff on that project. That's how it hit me. That's how personal it was for me. And then he passed the groove on over to Mel Brown on bass, and he laid his magic on it, man. Whew. That groove, that funky bass. They passed it over to Freddie Fox on guitar.
Love
him. My man Freddie, he just laid it down, laid it out. And then there was the song actually ended before the vamp. And I had sent him a couple of takes, and he liked all the takes. He was like, I'm going to build a vamp.
Love the vamp
over
solo.
What's a vamp?
The vamp is at the end of the song when you're done with the form of the song, you're done with the melody, and you just kind of ride out a groove. You know, it's just a groove, maybe a one chord, one or two chords over a groove, and just keep going and playing, and it takes the song up again. That's that live feel.
Yeah,
because live, when we get to that vamp,
it is
to the wall. So
he
threw that vamp in and said, man, we're going to use this solo too, man, because I couldn't figure out what to do with the solo. I want to pick and choose this. I'm just going to make another vamp on this solo. And Mel played it, and it out came past the groove. And
it really lifts it up.
Around.
It lifts it up at the end one more time. It gives you a little bit more silver plating.
Yeah, yeah.
And so
I was worried. Again, we got it. It was like a 5 or 6 minute song. So now we got to figure out how to make it radio. And I was like, I don't want to take anything out of here. And so we went back and forth with, all right, what do we cut out?
What we're talking about now is like when you submit a song to radio, typically when you put a song on your album, the length, I mean, you're not going to see 8 minute songs, but you might see 4 or 5 6 minute songs, you know, with everything in there. You can solo a little bit more and stuff like that. But when you submit it to radio, the radio only wants, what, 3.5 minutes?
3.5 to 4 minutes. If they put it in the deck and it's over 4 minutes, they're probably not even going to play it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you get it in, you get it down to 4 minutes because they've got programming, they've got
commercials.
And so you have to honor, you know, that system. And so you cut it down, you make a radio edit, but the trick is when you got a great song like that, what do you edit?
Yeah.
What do you edit out?
Yeah.
And so we realized we could take one of the melodies out and put it on. They said, well, why don't we take Michael Browning's Rhodes solo out?
I'm glad you left that in.
Because that builds up to the my solo. And that's if I just came in.
We don't want to do that.
There would be no build up to my solo.
Tasty. And that was a good call because normally our producers tell us, ixnan those guys and put us out there.
No, I said, we got to have,
because
it creates
too.
A bed, it gives a listener a break on the ear, and then I can come in, slide in, and then, you know, we can go out with it. So it worked. We got it down to 4 minutes, and the rest is history.
Wait, you know what? We need to listen to that thing. We're going to listen to it right now, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to leave the mics open, so feel free to say, hey, here's the vamp, here's the build-up to my solo.
Yeah.
I have a question, though, because when you've got a guest that's content rich, it's got a really nice line from starting trumpet at 11 to center front man, you made a comment, and I'm real curious about it. So your first record was called Groove Tree.
Uh-huh.
And now I kind of feel the same, too, about finding my own voice. This is my current record. I finally produced my own record.
Mm-hmm.
And I always tell my friends with good humor, when you throw Roberto Valli in the studio
and
Tony Moore.
He's on that CD, Robert.
You know, and guys like you, it's just like taking your receipts to your CPA.
Yeah, man.
I ain't no David Foster, but I don't need to tell Lin Rountree and Tony Moore how to play groove.
Exactly.
And I just stand there, and our friends bring magic.
They bring magic, man. That's why you give it. You don't. I don't like to say, hey, this is what you play. When I send it, I listen to something, I'm thinking of person's style. And sometimes, just because a person can play, their style may not fit that particular song.
We're musical casting directors.
Exactly. So you're trying to figure out, okay, whose style is going to fit this groove? And you just give it to them.
Yeah. And I'm not trying to.
When they bring it back,
they bring it back.
It's like, oh, wow.
When we were younger, the grown folks sort of told us, oh, I know this guy that can. But and I'm not trying to be flippant about diminishing great producers that we both know. But again, we tell Tony Moore, Mel Brown, just do your thing. I love to let my friends just do their thing.
Okay,
and the mixing agents come in later and you do their thing. But
okay, well, so we're going to play the song now.
Okay, great.
So, Lin, again, feel free to jump in.
Cool.
We're going to leave the mics open.
It's a great song.
Love it.
This is the full version because you left that bass at the front.
This is a closer and an intro.
Yeah.
You just come out, take your time. You did it.
Will likes to think about the opener.
I love that stuff. Tempo is killer. Why did you go to Harmon, not full tone? What was your decision on that, the Harmon?
Well, I think it was a better sound up front.
Yeah.
And it also led to the building of the song. When you hear the open trumpet in the middle after the Rhodes solo, it takes it to another level.
It's a bold and savvy move.
Yeah,
I love the horn. I love the close harmonies.
Yeah. That's about six stacked horn.
Is that Darren in there? Or who's the sax in there?
That's me. That's all trumpet.
Oh. I love it.
That's one of my tricks. I mix muted horn in my chords. So there's two mutes. There's four flugel parts and two trumpet parts.
Well, I love it.
Left and right stereo.
Love it.
Love the horn arrangement. Horns are killer.
Yeah, so I've got the flugels doing.
Clever.
And I got the trumpets moving, so I got a lot of counter movement.
I love that. Do you track the Harmon too in the section? It's a great sound like that.
And this is Mike on the key solo.
Killer solo.
Is this the build up to your solo?
Yeah. This is what they wanted. We were considering cutting that. I was like, oh no.
Oh, you need this. It's like a pre-chorus. It's a great sound.
D. Lucas says the bass is kicking butt.
D. Lucas is awesome.
And then you got the tambourine that takes an extra. That leads into my solo right here.
My dad's gonna say this is a goosebump moment. Goosebumps.
Music lover, no agenda.
Erica Duarte says, Lin is a brush fire.
Whoa, look out.
So this is the part we cut out for radio.
Oh, yeah.
But we didn't need that extra part here. We just went right into the...
That's smart.
But this is a good build-up, though.
It's nice to have it on the album.
Right. Yeah, it's the album. Now he just rips it right here.
Got a little Tom Brown in there. A lot of Freddie.
Thank you. signature right here.
I like that one.
We have Phil Denny in the house.
My man Phil.
Phil's got a great record out right now.
Good stuff.
This is a joint. It's just, you can...
We got the vamp coming up here?
This is the vamp.
It's the vamp, yeah. Okay.
I was gonna ask.
Do you have a live... How do you end this live?
I wish I could play it. We do a version. We just came up with a new version in Newport that just was killer. We did da na dun 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 da na dun 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 da na dun 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 da na da 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 ba da bump.
Oh, I love that.
Ba ba da ba da ba da ba da ba da bump da bump 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 ba na ba na bump ba na bump.
That's a whole song itself.
Ba na bump da bump bump da bump da bump da bump ba na ba.
Drama.
Yeah. That's the ending of that we just came up. My man Big Mike.
I love it.
Big Mike, aka Michael Hart Jr. and Tracy Carter came up with that for Newport.
That's great.
Well, that's awesome. What we're saying. Some of these songs take on a life of their own,
yeah.
And they grow and they become even better, right?
Yeah.
When people do it, I love how you guys talk about how you trust your players and you send it to them and mm-hmm. they make it even better than what you imagine, yeah. A lot of the time.
Well, that's the intent.
So again, this is off of Stronger Still, and that was the Billboard number one. Lin, one other question I want to ask you is the concept behind the name Stronger Still.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man. It is my sixth studio project, and you know, been in this game for a minute now. It's tough to make one CD, let alone
it
six.
It really is. Yeah.
And not because, well, you got a lot of challenges. You have life, you have family, you have finances,
yeah.
that inhibit people from continuing to move forward with their dreams. And so it is difficult to keep going. But once you realize your voice and you keep pushing, you realize that if you just stick with what you can control, and that's making good music, you can't control who puts you on a festival. You can't control where your song ends up on the charts. You can't control a lot of things in this industry, but you can control what music you create and put out. And so at this point in time, that's what was told to me, and I keep making great music, trying the best music that I can make, and on Stronger Still, it's a testament to me being in this game for a while now. I've got over 100 songs out there. I've got six CDs. I've produced for other people. I've appeared on a lot of other people's projects. Not yet.
We're going to do it.
We're going to happen.
I already got the goddess.
But
you'll be my trumpet on the intro.
I've done a lot of work, and to still be doing this and still be putting out CDs after all the stuff you have to go through, finances and family and all that other stuff. Some of your family members don't, sometimes they're, well, what are you doing? You know, you sure this is where we should be going? You should be spending all your money. So, I mean, it's tough. And so right now, this is a testament. Stronger Still is where I am. And these songs represent, you know, years.
If you guys go out and get this,
great.
This is not the only killer song on this album.
Oh no!
You know, this is not a one-hit wonder. There are tremendous songs in this. This whole CD is great, as was your last one, Soul Funk.
Thank you.
The
CD,
really, really good.
The CD, the tracks Jack shared with me that I got to enjoy this week, it sets a vibe. The collection is a vibe, which I think is a compliment. But how is this album different than your first Groove Tree as an artist? And I know, and then there's a lot of things that we do because someone tells us to stand behind a microphone and we trust this guy to put too much reverb
on our stuff.
But how is this album?
I think it's interesting to say, I think that album is most like Groove Tree than all of my other albums. I didn't know what I had with Groove Tree. Groove Tree I made because I was a club circuit musician in Detroit, and people kept saying, well, you know, we love your playing, we love what you're doing, you have a CD. And I was like, well, yeah, you know, I should maybe make a CD. I can make some extra money at my gigs, you know, sell them after the gig. He keeps asking me about a CD, so I'll just make a CD. I didn't know anything about smooth jazz or anything radio. I just made what I thought sounded great. I got with a couple of producers, Mr. Dana Davis and Billy Meadows, and these guys, man, they knew what they were doing with the music. I had this little QY-100 that I made the songs on. I gave these tracks. I said, here, Dana, do something with them. And he came back with these songs, and the album started to take a, a life of its own. I got some players that were gracious enough to come play with little old me, Mr. Al Turner. The Burner, you know, is on my first album. Ron Otis on drums. Both play with Kim. Billy Meadows, Dana Davis. A lot of great musicians made my stuff come to life. And my man, Mr. Tim Bowman, was Love gracious him. Enough great. To come. I'm like, Tim Bowman's coming to play on my stuff? But he epitomizes artists who like to give a hand up. Not a hand out, but a hand up to guys that he thinks are serious. And he saw me as one of the serious guys in the city wanting to really do something. So he came out and said, yeah, man, what do you want me to play? For Your Love is the first cut single that came off of that album.
Grooftree.
Off of Grooftree. Wow. And it set the standard for me. Everyone's saying, who is this Lin Rountree? Man, this is, I didn't know what I had. And so it was so pure, that whole album. And I had kind of gone away from it, trying to figure out the whole, the complex strategies and making
who
songs.
Who you were, though.
But this...
Trying to figure out who you were as an artist.
But this right now, it took me right back to, look, I'm just going to make music that I feel like I'm going to be happy playing on stage, that's going to sound good, that I want to play, that I want to hear, and that's what's Stronger Still. So that there's a direct connection to Grooftree. It's that's pure.
Love you know, we've been following you for a good 8-9 years now, seeing you at Humphreys and other places where we live in San Diego. And the one thing I want to say to our audience, you know, we go on the Dave Claus cruise, we go to the festivals. There are people playing in clubs, Lin Rountree for one, who just played Congratulations Newport Jazz Festival and killed it. Yeah. And Lin and I were talking before, and people were saying, Lin, where you been?
Yeah.
Like, you know, we love your playing. Like, why haven't we seen you? Yeah. Well, the point is, we don't have radio stations that much playing the music. Get out there anywhere you can see live music and... You know, go to your local club. In San Diego, we have the Mediterranean Jazz and Supper Club. Orange County, you have Spaghettini. You know, like all over the country, there's clubs. And these guys play in these jazz clubs.
Well, the one thing that you just hit the nail on the head, after I played Newport, we drew the crowd up. Everybody was so happy. They were elated. They came to the city. Where you been? We kind of heard about you, but why weren't you on the main stage? I'm saying, well, look, you know, it's up to
Request
you all,
it, yeah.
the fans, yeah. to make, to articulate that to
right.
the promoters.
Right.
The promoters are, if you're going to attend these festivals and the festivals are going to be packed, the promoters have no incentive to do anything different outside of when you go to the promoters and talk to them and say, hey, we want to see this guy. We want to see that. We want something new. We love our experienced guys. We love the mature guys on the festivals. That's fine. It's great. We come because what we want to see the Lin Rountrees, because Lin Rountrees, they make us feel good. That's the bottom line. So I told all the fans, look, I appreciate the warm wishes, and I appreciate you thanking me, but please, you can thank me by talking to the promoters, talking to the festival leaders, saying, hey, look, because they listen to you. Sometimes they don't listen to us.
Yeah.
In fact,
you know what I like, though?
But they listen to the fans.
What I love about your career path, you know, when you start the business, you're making Grooftree, then you wake up in 2018 and you go, wow, I got 15 Billboard tunes, I got 6 albums. You have young guys now at Cannonball coming up, how do I do what you do? And we're in a good way still trying to, you know, we're still trying to
I don't know, I'm still trying to do what I do. So
but we never, I don't think you ever get out of that mindset. But what I love about you is you've always built a pyramid of quality. It's just good stuff.
Yeah, thank you.
Because I've seen some people come out with a release that just looks midi-ish, and it's just shortchanged, corners cut.
Yeah.
I don't feel that about your path, but you know, I like to digress once in a while.
Go ahead, Will.
I'm just really inspired by your beginnings, like going to the Duke Ellington thing. What is that? When you're 11 playing trumpet, you got a chance to do something like that. What is that? It just sounds so inspiring.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, you don't know. You just you get a way to get out of class and you know, go do your music studies and all this stuff. And you try to get a note out of the trumpet. It's like playing golf. You try to hit the ball, and if you hit
So how'd you end up picking up a trumpet?
Well, that's what it was. I was trying to get out of class. Yeah. One, two, my father had a cornet. This is a
Your dad
story.
Had one?
My dad had a cornet that he was passed down from his mother. He played a little bit, but he kind of switched to the guitar. So he always kept that. My dad was the ultimate Jedi master. So he kept the original Jedi master. He kept the cornet on a mantelpiece in our living room. And he said, hey, son, you can touch anything in this room except that cornet. And of course, the one thing as a kid you want to touch is is the one thing you can't touch. Right. You're not supposed to touch. Right. So he put one day he put a little pin on it, like on the bottom of it, to see if I had moved it. And so I went and I said, oh, I got this. I feel, you know, I'm in trouble. Am I going to be in trouble? I'll put it back. He said, I see you touched it. He was like, now you got to play it. Wow. And so that's what happened. I ended up playing it, and I stuck with it all through. I got the one note on it. It's like you hit that one good golf shot. Got the one good note, and I was hooked to the trumpet. And then when I graduated high school, my graduation gift was that cornet. And he said, take that cornet and that's put it on your mantelpiece and just realize this is, you know, this is a foundation for you, and this is where everything started.
That's interesting that he chose the instrument that would be your instrument for your art. That's pretty incredible.
It was fortuitous, and so I mean it's one of those stories, and that's what keeps me grounded. When I look at that cornet, when I come in and I'm tired, or I'm like, why aren't they playing my music, or why don't I get this show, why don't I get that show, or should I be doing this? I look at that cornet right on my mantelpiece, and I said, that's why.
You made one comment that I love. You said, you know, you want to make the audience feel good, and I got to tell you, having attended quite a few of your shows, I always walk away feeling good. I as you know, like I take photos and sometimes videos, and sometimes I feel myself smiling during the show, right? That's what it should be all about. I never walk away from a Lin Rountree show without feeling good. And, you know, the people in this genre are rabid about this genre. Yeah. They love it.
They love their smooth jazz. And they're loyal.
And you're talking about middle-aged people that get down.
Yeah, actually.
They're going to a festival. They're going to your show. They want to dance.
Throw your hands
they
up
want to
the
get
herb.
Up. Yeah. They want to have a couple of drinks. Mm-hmm. They want to act like they're teenagers.
Exactly.
And they do.
It's not so much about getting down at this age, it's about getting up.
That's true, Will.
Yeah,
Will. Dun, 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 dun.
Will, good point in my case.
I'm just telling you. You know what? I got to tell you, though, I'm just a fan of yours. You know, sometimes in LA, we have these circles we travel in, and I kind of tend to. I'm such a loyalist. If I got a bass player, I got him for life.
That's how we all are, though.
I just. After hearing your music this week, you know, we work so hard to be the front guy. Yeah, and it's like last thing you want to do is just have Marcus be right at your side, like, oh, well, he's great, but I don't mean I'm trying to be the front man, you know. But I just would love to work with you. I just, even if it's studio stuff,
Let's do it, man.
I just love the energy.
We've performed together a couple
times. No, we have, and I loved it.
So now
we share something. We did not major in music. You got a bachelor's of administration in business administration at. Yeah. FAMU.
Yep, Florida A&M University.
Now, why not do the music thing? I had my reasons, but I'm happy that I did it. Because you're really savvy at your business.
And I think that's what you hit another nail on the head, is that this music is a business.
Yeah.
And it's not enough just to be a talented musician. I mean, there's a lot of talented musicians, super talented musicians, who never see the light of day in their music because they don't understand the business.
Yeah.
And it is a business. And so you have to temper that. You don't want to go too business, be too eclectic. But you have to understand. And you know, I got that degree because, you know, obviously there's a reality to life. You want to fall back on something. You want to have your education. And so I felt like, you know, me having the business, because I went down and I was recruited into the university, Florida A&M University, Marching 100, call it 100.
Yeah, I want to hear about that.
The best band in the world.
William Foster and those guys, right?
Yeah, William P. Foster.
How did you like him? Was he killer?
He was.
They're scientists, aren't they?
He was emeritus when we were there. So Dr. Julian White was our band director, but Doc was still on. He was still there, and I learned a lot. I learned how to perform under a lot of duress and pressure.
So you were doing that. But
did you guys dance when you played too?
Oh yeah, we danced. We had to before the weekend show. We had to what we call shake the tree, and so each one of you got out in your section and you performed the dance routine by yourself. So I was the trumpet player. You had the sax player. You had the tuba player. You had all the other instruments. We all would do it individually, and we would do this in front of the entire band.
Wow!
And we do the dance piece, and we dance and play.
If
you didn't cut it, then you didn't get on the field.
That would eliminate white Jewish guys like me. We would have been gone.
We had a couple of white guys down there.
We can't get up.
And we had a couple of African American people. who didn't necessarily understand the soul in the group.
Yeah, they were so clapping on 1 and 3.
Yeah, exactly. It was all subjective a little bit. But
were there any white Jewish guys in that band? I'm kind of curious. He's thinking.
I bet money. No.
We had a couple.
It was a klezmer clarinetist.
White chocolate. We had a couple guys named White Chocolate in the band.
That's a great title.
Yeah, a couple guys named White Chocolate.
Like, can we use that?
There was a White Chocolate in the band. The band name was White Chocolate.
I like that.
Coming up. So yeah, but I learned a lot there. I mean, you know, you're performing in that 30-pound uniform for 30,000 people, and it kind of gives you something. And I play when I'm on stage, you know, I'm one of these trumpet players, and sometimes my lips move around. I move all around the stage. I'm here, I'm there, I'm here, I'm there. I want to give a show. I'm drenched in sweat after my show, but I want to give as much as I can. But I got that from the band.
Wow, that's really inspiring.
Yeah.
So you found your voice with this last record. It kind of doesn't it make you chomping at the bit to crank another one out? Because you got
I mean, you just feel good. We already got other songs that didn't make the album, that not because they weren't good, but because they sometimes didn't fit. You already got other songs. You got a whole list of songs that we're going to try and explore. Of course, I'm going into I'm an R&B guy, really. I am not a jazz musician. I love jazz. Some of my influences were Lee Morgan, Freddie Hubbard, of course, Miles Davis. I mean, it's incredible that Miles Davis was Charlie Parker's music director.
Yeah.
But 4 decades later, he's playing a cover, one of the best covers ever of Time After Time. Or Human Nature is the most requested smooth jazz song ever is Human Nature, Miles Davis.
I love Tutu.
So when you have a guy that transcends industries like that, and Quincy Jones I'm an R&B guy at heart, though. I don't call myself a traditional jazz musician. I love it, but I'm an R&B guy, and so that's why it's sometimes you get pigeonholed if you're a trumpet player. You either, he's got to be a jazz trumpeter, or he's got to be a horn section guy. No, I'm an R&B guy. So a lot of my songs, if you take
this genre, that's what they want.
Yeah, if you put vocals
you fit exactly this genre.
What's cool, though, you cite your influences, Lee Morgan, Miles, Freddie Hubbard, and Tom Brown. I love Tom Brown.
Tom Brown, that's my guy.
Tom Brown, you know that song, Funk in Jamaica?
Off the
Love Around album?
That's my guy, yeah.
It kind of reminds me of you, though. You know, you did Groove Tree right away, and accidentally, that was kind of your resource cache of good tunes. His song, Funkin' for Jamaica, was on the second album he put out, just like boom.
Boom.
And there it was. But
Thighs High is my favorite Tom Brown song.
Okay, so we're going to play another Lin Rountree song here. So is this your current single, My Time With You?
That is.
It is.
Yep.
So we're going to play the current single.
Okay.
That's moving up the charts too, right?
Cool,
Can we leave the mics on?
We'll leave the mics on
again.
I like
the comments you've made. They're
great. You
want
to first set up the song for us.
Yeah. Well, this is one of the songs that I had written probably myself and Mr. Dana Davis wrote 8-9 years ago. And this is one of the first songs that we took over to Michael Browning to try and put a melody on and try to figure out what we do. Because it had been sitting in my hard drive for, almost a decade. And so we said, hey, man, can you do something with this? Can you, because I can't really hear a melody. And that's what we do sometimes. We lean on other people to, just because you can do something doesn't mean you should do it. So I farm my stuff out sometimes. Hey, man, put a melody on it. He put a melody on it, loved the groove. We got Thanos Hannes on guitar, on acoustic guitar. And he and I put this thing together, man, and out came this gem.
And what should we listen for? Of course, you're going to tell us as we play it, but any particular things you want us to listen to?
No, I mean, the song is, it speaks for itself. I just love I love the combo of the, one of the first tunes that I've had where I've had got acoustic guitar playing on it. There's some rhythm guitar in the back, but of the acoustic guitar and the trumpet sound, I'm actually playing flugel on this song too. So I'm playing flugel on it, and it's just a nice feel good song. There's really no interesting story like the other songs. It's just a great song.
Okay, here we go.
Right away, there's no questions.
Michael Brony. He came with that melody.
That's your trumpet stack?
Yeah.
That is very pleasing, dude. Just turned my head with that concept. Big compliment. And
by the way, I love that song.
Thank you.
I
man.
Do too.
That that song is killer.
Yeah, then what makes it is that the groove, it's the beat, the 2-time beat underneath.
You know, you were saying feel good. The two songs we played, you can't help but feel good. You really can't.
Well, yeah, I like melodies too. I mean, I like funk and soul, but yeah, I like beautiful melodies too, man.
Oh, that had a beautiful melody. Yeah, I like beautiful melodies. Love the melody on that.
I want to pay you a compliment. In our genre, in our instrumental family, there's 5 billion of us.
That's a lot.
And I see you guys, and you can count them, you know. I don't need to go down the drill.
Trumpet players, yeah.
But, you know, what I like about Chris Bodie is he's thought, okay, I don't know if I want to do the golf cart and the dust in my teeth,
yeah,
4 o'clock slot.
Yeah,
I'm just gonna go to the theaters.
Oh,
and I'm happy, and I put a little Tom Ford suit on,
and he's very happy and very,
and I see you when I up close like this and how well spoken you are. I think your theater persona would, the way you tell your story, I'm telling you.
Yeah, man.
And that's a nice
but
that's a nice career path.
I still like dust and golf carts.
I do too.
I like dust and golf carts, man. I like those festivals.
I do too. But you know what? You got the personality to hit that theater circuit with your song selections.
Yeah.
I'm serious.
And that's another thing. When we do shows, I look at my audience, and I don't just do the same show. I see what my audience is, and I design my set list based on, like, sometimes we can open up past the grooves. Sometimes we end with it. I've got a couple of burner songs, though. I'm trying to figure out, okay, where do I put these burner songs, you know, in the set? And, you know, I'm trying to figure out who's on the show with me.
Yeah.
Who do I want to, am I, that person's going to, like, Will Downing, we went on after Will Downing, and I knew Will Downing was going to be a little mellow. So the second set, we opened up with Pass the Groove to pick the crowd back up.
Right,
I do that strategically. Yeah. I put my set list together strategically.
And you know, another thing I'm noticing lately?
Yeah, both of you could speak to the set list, what you're trying to accomplish with your set list for our audience.
Well, I was going to actually go another direction, because a lot of us are getting packaged together, and sometimes it's, like you said, promoter-driven, which is great. But when I see a lineup, and I just love the tunes. Like, if I had a package with Lin, I know I can go get a coffee before I come on, and he's going to bring it and hold it and take up. But when you do a package and someone's not necessarily meshing,
yeah.
and you're just kind of up there.
Yeah.
But I love that package thing.
Yeah.
The artists like you in a package, you could call any tune in any order, and I would trust his selection.
Yeah.
I know he would find the right closer, even if I'm slated. If he says, Willie, we got to do this.
Well,
and I love that, the song selection. Yeah.
And that's important, particularly myself, and I've done a bunch of packages. Right now, the Motown Philly thing, my man, Mr. David P. Stevens, he and I got together. We've got complimentary songs. Some of the songs aren't alike, because he's got some songs with an R&B vibe, so he actually trusted me to go through the set list. And say, let's put this together. Then I sent it back to him. I said, what do you think? He said, well, let's move this around here. And I think we got something. And the first time we debuted
I can't wait to see it tomorrow.
In Atlanta at St. James Lane Live, it just worked. It worked.
Love it.
So you guys are going to get it. I mean, it's going to, the set is going to be consistent. It's going to be consistently soulful tomorrow night.
Well, let's reset the show. And I want to show you, Lin, how you've arrived and how great you are. Look, we haven't even broke a sweat, and we got 7 minutes left. And I still want to ask you about your folks' occupations. But anyway, so if you're just joining us, you're listening to Inside the Music with a very stunning guest who is got an evolved artistry and an amazing engagement with the craft. You've got to be at Mediterranean tomorrow night. It's worth it. It's so close to you.
Mediterranean Jazz and Supper Club
in San Diego.
Up close and personal. It's a great venue, like Jack said. It's kind of a wide, fun venue, so you can see the person in the front row just right there, and you can talk to him.
Yeah.
You got to come to this show. If you need a ride, meet me at the Trader Joe's in La Quinta. I'll be at the produce section.
So everybody that wants tickets, it's www.whatsupdaygo.com. And again, we only have 3 minutes before Lynn's going to play live.
Yep.
So, Lin, why don't you catch us up with where people can see you, where they can get your music, and what you're working on, and you know what's up and coming for you.
Well, right now I got a packed schedule. I'm somewhere every weekend leading all the way up until the end of the year almost. And so we're just supporting the Stronger Still album right now. Of course, I do collabs with other people. We've got some things we're working on. We've got an R&B collab that I'm working on with a couple singers. But other than that, it's summertime. It's time to get out and have fun. And you can always see where I am, what I'm doing, and hear more about me by going to my website at www.linrountreemusic.com. That's L-I-N, Rountree with no D, music.com. And from there, you can connect with me on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. You can sign up for my newsletter. You get a regular newsletter every month that lets you know what I'm doing. And you can also see all my discography and purchase CDs, and download some pictures, see where I'm performing, everything. So I appreciate everybody always. It's always much love. What I do is for the fans. What I do is for the people, and I just like to make people feel good. So.
And so for people that are watching who maybe came in late or in the middle of the show, you can watch the show anytime on Lynn's page.
Yep.
On Will's page, on my page, on Mikey's page, or LA Talk Radio, anytime that you want. So if you missed something, and it was a pretty meaty show, you don't want to miss anything, tune back in. So we have a minute. Will, do you want anything you wanted to ask? We have 1 minute.
This has been one of my favorite shows because it's such an evolved artist. I love the work output that you do, and I'm just... Selfishly, I just fell in love with your music this week again. And there's so much going on out there.
Thank you, man.
We both know there's so much going on out there. You could just do this all the way. And I just, the sound of your horn, the melodies, and I just always thank you. you know, this guy loves his music. he'll send you music during the middle of the day.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
and this man,
these guys, thank you
guys
really so much
people,
for having
man.
Me, man. I've known you for now years.
It's a pleasure. Yep.
And every time you've been so supportive of me, so supportive of the music, you take great pictures, man.
They
you
do.
Always get my
thanks.
Great shooter
yeah,
pictures,
yeah.
man.
Thanks.
And you help spread what I'm doing out to the masses, man. With your videos, with your pictures, with your
and they have no agenda. They just love music.
There's no agenda, you know. And we get the exposure because of you guys, man.
Yeah.
So much love to both.
Well,
of
we
you,
appreciate
man.
It. Then getting back to the point, if you're lucky enough to have a jazz club in your community, ask to have Lin Rountree, Will Donato, play there, and trust your promoter of that local jazz club that he's going to curate a good series for you.
Yeah.
Maybe you hadn't heard of Lin Rountree before, but you will go into Mediterranean Jazz and Supper Club or Spaghettini or St. James
right.
or
yeah.
Perfect Note
Perfect
or all
Note,
these
yeah.
clubs mm-hmm. around the country
great clubs,
are
great
have great artists, yeah. great music, and great club owners. You know, there's a thriving music scene out there. You know, partake in it. Go out, buy your ticket.
Support.
And and enjoy, because
yep.
Lin Rountree's out to entertain you.
I'm out
there. He is.
Yep.
Speaking of entertaining, let's do that.
Yeah, let's play a song off of my fourth project, Serendipitous. It's a song written by myself and Mr. Nate Harrison, produced by Nate Harrison, and it's on Serendipitous. It's called We Chill. It's a great single.
That's a great title.
It's fitting for this lazy Saturday afternoon.
Nice.
Or morning. Afternoon for me in Detroit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Lynn's going to play for you here, and I'm going to mute our mics. Thank you.
Sounds okay. Great. I think Lin has an award of the best sounding guest with the awesome foot pedals. Yeah. Did you tell him that you have to give your boutique pedals to the hosts if you appear on the show?
Oh yeah,
no, I'll tell you, man.
The fishman.
That is slick there.
Quite the setup.
I was the configuration.
I like when you lean on that six.
We're talking about this right here. So anyway, Lin, thank you so much.
Thank you guys.
We're so grateful for you coming in.
Yeah.
And so happy to have had you on our show.
Thank you.
And everybody, come to the Mediterranean Jazz Summer Club. Our next show will be the 23rd, 2 weeks from now, which we're violating our first and third Saturday protocol. But we had an opportunity to get another out of towner, Darren Ron.
Darren, also my man. That's my man.
Yeah. So Darren Ron will be on June 23rd.
He's a great producer and even better person.
Great guy.
Right? Yeah. So we're excited.
Takes one to know one.
To have in on. Yeah. So everybody, share the Facebook feed with your friends so they can watch the show too. And if you missed any of it, please go back. And thank you so much.
Thank you guys for tuning in.
Great, safe weekend, everybody.
Much love to you guys.
Thanks for tuning in.
It's Inside the Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music.